Okay, okay. Shalom, shalom to all of the brothers and sisters out there. Shalom. This is the Milk Deliverance of Israel, the Sea Souls of Israel Camps. Once again, coming right back at you with another quick hitter. First off, I would like to say all honor, thanks, praise, and glory to our Heavenly Father and His only begotten Son, Yahweh, Bahashem, Hamashiach, Yahushai, Bahashem, Ruach HaKadosh. Much love to all of the brothers and sisters out there, no matter if you're part of a camp or not, that's pushing this biblical truth with all faith and sincerity, with the spirit of Yahweh, Yahushai, of course. In this segment, it's going to be the proper way on how to pray, right? And the reason why I decided to do this segment is because a lot of our people, man, they have this thing misconstrued about how to pray, man. The proper way to pray, right? And I can't blame them, because I can't blame myself. You know, this is what we've been taught our whole entire lives, man, according to religious Christianity and Roman Catholicism, right? So as you can see on my screen here, you have all the depictions up here on how most of our people pray, right? So you have an image right here of a prayer circle, right? And then you have right here on the right side of the screen, a lot of people holding hands here, right? Just like this right here. You got people holding hands, you got people standing in prayer circles, okay, out in public, right? To be seen of men, right? You got this right here, okay? Then of course you got how your Muslims pray in Islam, right? They got their head tilted to the ground, right? So this is how our people think that we should pray, man. And this is what we've been taught how to pray all of our lives, right? Got some people here praying earnestly. You can see it all on her face. You know, like she think that the Most High is going to hear her more, right? It's because she's in tears and she's crying and she's looking as what you would call, or what the religious Christian would say, holier than thou, right? Then of course you got your prayer hands, okay? Like how most of our people love to pray. They like to do it like this right here, or like this, or like that, right? So this is how we've been taught to pray, man. All of our lives, this is what we do, right? Right here, you got the brother, you got his head tilted to the earth. Of course, you got more prayer circles, right? And all of this right here is vanity, man. And it's to be seen of men, right? Now, according to the biblical scripture, there's nowhere in there that tells you that you should form prayer circles, okay? And praying out in public. As a matter of fact, as you can see here, around all of the people in the background, right? So they're doing that right there so the people in the background can say, oh, wow, look at them. They're praying over there. Oh, they must be church-going folk, right? So-called holier than thou, right? So I got a couple of scriptures that I want to bring out about this right here on the proper way to pray, right? Because a lot of our people, this, as I said, man, they got it misconstrued and confused and messed up out here, and they think that the Most High is hearing them while they do this right here, okay? Why they doing stuff like this right here, okay? Just because you're out in public and a whole lot of people see you praying doesn't mean that the Most High hears your prayers, man, especially if you're not doing it the proper way, right? So we're about to get into it, man. You know what I'm saying? Hopefully that this is going to edify the people on how the proper way to pray, right? Should have got me a rubber band, tie my hair up. All right, so the first book that I want to go to is the book of St. Matthew, chapter 6. All right. I So we're going to go to the book of St. Matthew, chapter 6, and I'm going to start at verse 5. Okay. And it reads, "And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues," all right? Or in this case right here, they love to stand praying in public, right? Or like this right here, okay? Or like this right here. All of these prayer circles, man, okay? So basically, that's what you would call your modern day synagogue as it's being spoken of right here, right? I'm going to start over. "And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets," all right? "That they may be seen of men," okay? Meaning the people that's around them, the men or women, it really doesn't matter, right? "Verily, I say unto you, they have their reward," okay? So they're praying to the Most High, hoping that the Most High hear their prayers, but their reward is being seen of men, right? As I was saying before, seeming holier than thou, as the religious Christians say, right? So that's their reward. People going to see them praying in the street, and then the people going to say, "Oh, wow, look at all of those people over there praying. They must be godly people. They're over there praying," right? So basically, that's going to be their reward, okay? As Yahawashi says, now this is written in red letter too, but you can't see it here, right? "Verily, I say unto thee, they have their reward." Verse 6, "But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet," all right? Your closet in your home, all right? Your private place, okay? Where no one can see you, all right? "Enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to the Father which is in secret." Okay, who's the Father in secret? That's the Most High. All right, the reason why he's in secret, because we can't see him in the physical eye. All right, let's read that again. "But thou," which is you, "when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret," meaning he's going to see you in your secret place, in your closet, with your door closed, right? "And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly," meaning in front of everyone, he's going to bless you openly, right? Verse 7, "But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking," all right? So when you're out here and you're praying in public, trying to make it seem like you're so-called holier than thou in front of the people, you know, you like to throw up long prayers. You like to talk about this. You like to talk about that. You like to talk about what this person's going through, that person's going through. And then you call yourself praying for them, right? But what the Most High calls it, through Yahawashi, vain repetitions, all right? "As the heathen do, for they think that they should be heard for their much speaking." Verse 8, "Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father, which is the Most High, knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, O Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as in heaven." Slakia. "Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. So it be. For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father, which is the Most High, will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father, the Most High, forgive your trespasses? All right, so if someone makes a mistake and they trespass against you, and you recognize that it's a mistake, you should forgive them, right? You know, don't hold no grudge against them and think that they've done it purposely, because, you know, for the most part, they haven't done it purposely, right? So if you sense that it's a mistake, then forgive them, right? But if you want to be stubborn and you want to think that the person done it purposely to hurt your feelings or to hurt you physically, then the Most High is not going to forgive you, right? So basically, that's the way you're supposed to pray, okay? And it starts from verse 9 here, right? And we're going to go over that again. So this is all you need to say. You don't need to be out there throwing up all of these vain repetitions, as it says right here in verse 7, right? And making long speeches and long prayers that last for like 10 minutes, 15 minutes. All of that is nonsense in the eyes of the Most High, right? That's all vanity, right? So starting from verse 9 again. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth, and it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. So it be. All right. So that's how you pray. Okay. You don't need to be like your religious Christian out there making 10 minute and 15 minute prayers, throwing up all of these vain repetitions, right? Oh, I need a house. I need a car. I need money for this. I need money for that. My kids need new clothes and shoes, right? All of that stuff is vanity, man. You don't need to be praying like that, right? But that's how our people is, man. You know what I'm saying? They think that the Most High doesn't know our spirit and he doesn't know what we need, right? But as it says right here, as you go back up, right? Let me see, what verse is it in right here? Okay. Verse 8. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask them. So before you even praying, it's already been ordained that the Most High know what you need, right? So you don't need to tell the Most High, oh, I need this, I need that, I need money for this, I need money for that, I need shoes, I need clothes, or whatever, right? I need a new house. I need my house worked on or whatever. I need my car fixed, right? The Most High already know that, man, right? So you don't need to throw up your vain repetitions, man, thinking that the Most High is going to hear you more than other people's prayers, right? So we're going to jump down to verse 31, right? Verses 31 through 34, and it reads, therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed, right? So that's basically throwing up your vain repetitions again. You know, you're telling the Most High exactly what you need, right? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, all right? Your carnal-minded person, your lawless people, okay? For after all of these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that ye need of all these things, all right? So it's basically reiterating verse 8 again, right? I'm going to read that again. For your heavenly Father, which is the Most High, knoweth that ye have need of all these things, but seek ye first the kingdom of the Most High and his righteousness. What is the righteousness? That's the laws of the Most High, right? And all these things shall be added unto you. Verse 34. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, which is tomorrow, right? For the morrow shall take thought for things of itself, Salakia, for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof, right? So you shouldn't be worrying about tomorrow. If you got enough on your plate to deal with today, then deal with what's going on today, right? You don't need to worry about tomorrow. You don't need to worry about next week. You don't need to worry about next month or whatever, right? One day at a time, as our people like to say, right? So this is basically what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to take things one day at a time and don't worry about the next day, all right? So the next one we're going to go to is in the book of Exodus, which is in the Old Testament. Chapter 9, I'm going to start at verse 28. Okay, so this is the book of Exodus, chapter 9, verse 28. And it reads, "And Moses said unto him, As soon as I am gone out of the city, I will spread abroad my hands unto the Most High." All right? So basically, this is Moses letting you know how to pray. And this is in the Old Testament, right? So he said, "I will spread abroad my hands unto the Most High," right? Now, I think I had a depiction here on a brother how he was doing it, right? He had his hands spread it abroad, all right? So I'm going to give you an example. All right, so here you go right here. Okay, so basically this is what having your hands spread abroad, right? So that's how you pray, man. Not like this right here, which is so-called prayer hands, okay? So this is how our people been taught to pray, or like this right here, okay? Your so-called prayer hands, right? Or as I was saying before, in your prayer circles, right? Like this right here. This is how we've been taught to do it, man. And this is how the Gentiles pray, man. This is how the pagans pray. This is what you would call a pagan prayer circle, right? There's nowhere in the scriptures where it says to do that, man. You're not supposed to form circles and pray in public, all right? As I just read to you in the book of St. Matthew, chapter 6, on how you should pray, you should go in your closet, okay? So I'm going to go back to the book of Exodus. All right. We're going to start at verse 28 again. Okay. Let me make sure I'm at the right. All right, this is Exodus 9, chapter 9 verse 28, right? Verse 29 here. And it reads, "And Moses said unto them, As soon as I am gone out of the city, I will spread abroad my hands unto the Most High, and the thunder shall cease, neither shall there be any more hail, that thou mayest know how that the earth is the Lord's," which is the Most High, right? Meaning that everything in the world and the world itself belongs to the Most High, right? And you can even read verse 28 here. It says, "Entreat the Lord, for it is enough," all right? So to entreat means to pray unto the Most High. You know, just that's all you do. You just pray unto the Most High, man, right? As in Matthew 6, you don't need to throw up all of your vain repetitions and all of your long prayers, right? All right, "Entreat the Lord, for it is enough that there be no more mighty thunderings in hell, and I will let you go, and ye shall stay no longer." Okay? So that's all we're supposed to do, man. Just entreat the Most High, right? I'm going to jump down to verse 33, and it reads, "And Moses went out of the city from Pharaoh, and spread abroad his hands unto the Most High, and the thunders and hail ceased, and the rain was not poured upon the earth." Okay, so when Moses entreated to the Most High, He just prayed that the thunderings and the hell stop, right? He didn't throw up all of those vain repetitions and 10-minute, 20-minute prayers, asking the Most High what to do. He just entreated with the Lord for those particular things, right? And the Most High heard his prayer, and he answered him, all right? And as it says here in verse 33 again, and the thunders and the hail cease, and the rain was not poured upon the earth, all right? But how Moses done it? And Moses went out of the city from Pharaoh, okay? He didn't do it in front of Pharaoh or in front of Pharaoh's soldiers, right? Moses went out of the city from Pharaoh and spread abroad his hands onto the Most High, all right? So basically, Moses went into his secret place there to pray, okay? The next one I want to go to is in the book of 1 Kings, chapter 8. And I'm going to go down to verse 22. So I'm going to go from verses 22 to 24. And it reads, and Solomon stood before the altar of the Most High in the presence of all the congregation of Israel and spread forth his hands towards heaven. And he said, Lord God of Israel, there is no God like thee in heaven above or on earth beneath, who keepest covenant and mercy with thy servants that walk before thee with all thy heart. So when you walk in before the Most High with all your heart, you're keeping his laws, statutes, and commandments, right? Verse 24, who has kept with thy servant David, my father, that thou promised him, thou speakest also with thy mouth and hast fulfilled it with thy hand as it is this day. Okay. So once again, it says right here, right? And Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the congregation of Israel and spread forth his hands towards heaven. All right. So that's how you pray, man. Okay, you're not supposed to have your hand together like this right here, all right? Or like this right here, or like this right here, right? This is how our people pray, man. So you're not supposed to have your palms closed and together like this, forming a triangle, right? Like your so-called prayer circle, okay? Okay. So when you're praying, you're supposed to have your palm spread it abroad and praying towards the Most High, right? Okay, so the next one I'm going to go to is the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 6. And I'm going to start at verses 34 through 35, all right? And it reads, if thy people go out to war against their enemies by the way that thou shalt send them, and they pray unto thee towards this city, which thou hast chosen, and the house which I have built for thy name. Okay, so the city that the Most High is talking about is Jerusalem, which is in Israel, right? Now, from where we are in the world today, it's towards the east, okay? Now, a lot of our people, they think that that comes out of the unholy Quran, right? Or the Furan, as I like to call it. But this right here came from the scriptures, man, which is the Holy Bible, as it says right here, right? I'm going to read that again, verse 34. If thy people go out to war against their enemies by the way that thou shalt send them, and they pray unto thee towards this city which thou hast chosen, and the house which I have built for thy name, right? Then hear thou from the heavens their prayer and their supplication, and maintain their cause, which is their pray, right? So not only do you supposed to have your hands in a formation like this right here, right? Supposed to have your hands like this right here, right? When you're praying, your palms up towards the heavens, towards the Most High. I'm trying to put it where you can see it, right? And you're supposed to be facing the east. So this is how you're supposed to pray, man. Not like this right here, not like this right here, right? Like this right here. Okay, your palms turn towards the heavens, right? Verse 35 again. Then hear thou, who is the thou? That's the Most High, right? Then hear thou from the heavens their prayer and their supplication, and maintain their cause. All right, so whatever you asking the Most High to do for you in that situation, he's going to hear you if you're praying the proper way, right? The next one I want to go to is in the book of Ezra, chapter 9. And I'm going to start at verse 5. Okay, verses 5 through 8. And it reads, and at the evening sacrifice, I arose up from my heaviness, and having rent my garment and my mantle, I fell upon my knees and spread out my hands unto the Lord my God. Okay, spread out my hands. All right. It's like this right here. Spread out my hands, right? Towards the Most High. That's how you're supposed to do it. Okay. Verse 6. And said, O my God, I am ashamed and blushed to lift up my face to thee. Okay. So you're supposed to lift up your face towards the Most High when you're praying, not having your head tilted down towards the ground, right? My God, for our iniquities are increased over our head, and our trespass, which is the transgression of the Most High's laws, statutes, and commandments, right? Is grown up onto the heavens. Verse 7. Since the days of our fathers have we been in a great trespass unto this day, all right? Even to this day right here in the year of 2020, right? We're still transgressing the Most High's laws, right? And for our iniquities, which is sin, have we, our kings and our priests, been delivered into the hand of the kings of the lands. The kings of the lands is which is the heathen, all right? The other nations that was round about the Israelites. To the sword, to the captivity, and to a spoil, okay, to be destroyed, and to confusion of face as it is this day. And this is exactly what our people are going through, man. We are spoiled and we're still in captivity, right? And to confusion of face, right? That's the reason why we're out there marching, talking about no justice, no peace. We've been doing that since the 1940s, man. And nothing still has changed. As a matter of fact, it seems like it's getting worse, right? So that's the reason why it says, and to confusion of face, as it is this day. So we still don't even know what the hell we're going on, man. We're out here doing all of these marches, all of these protests, right? And to make things worse, everyone is not even in the same spirit. They don't even have the same beliefs, right? You have this group of people over here, they're into Islam. You have this other group over here, they into religious Christianity. You have your Baptists out there. You have your Jehovah's Witness, right? You have your Seventh-day Adventists out there, your Pentecostal, right? Everyone's in different beliefs, man. Your Mormons out there, right? You even have some of the people of the other nations out there. You know, they believe in different gods, right? Some of them is agnostic or Gnostic, which is basically a fancy way of saying atheist. You don't even believe in God, right? So you have all of these people out here, man. You got all of these down low witches out there, right? You got your LGBTQ community, right? So all of them, they come together in a vain gathering, which is for your so-called Black Lives Matter, but everyone still have different spiritual beliefs, man. So still, everyone is separated in a way. Even though they're all coming together for Black Lives Matter, but they still separated with their beliefs, man, at the end of the day. So that's not going to work, man, right? That's the reason why we're out here marching for no justice, no peace ever since like the 1940s, right? And things still haven't changed to this day. As it says right here, since the days of our fathers have we been in great trespass, okay, unto this day. And for our iniquities have we, our kings and our priests, been delivered into the hands of the kings of the lands, all right? That would be your so-called POTUS, okay? Or your Queen of England, the UK, right? Or wherever we're scattered abroad, right? Canada, South Africa, all right? India, okay? To the sword, which means the destruction, all right? To the captivity. All right, that's where we're at now. We're in captivity. That's the reason why we're still paying tax. That's the reason why we still have to wake up like 3-4 in the morning just to make ends meet, right? Just to pay your bills, okay? Just to keep a roof over your head and food in your refrigerator, right? Clothes on your back, okay? So this is captivity, man. And to a spoil, to be destroyed. We out here worshiping different gods, different deities, believing in all of these false, vain philosophies and dogmas, right? So we're destroyed as a nation of people, man. Just as I said, you have your Black Lives Matter, right? Then you have your religious Christian in there. You have your Kemet in there. You have your agnostics in there, your atheists in there, right? So this is what it is, man. And to a spoil, right? Destroyed in the mind. And to confusion of face, all right? As it is this day, verse 8. And now for a little space, grace have been shown from the Most High, our God, to leave us a remnant to escape. All right, who's the remnant? That's the ones that's keeping the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High. That's keeping the seventh day Sabbath. That's keeping the dietary law, keeping the high holy days, the moral laws. All right, that's the remnant right there. And to give us a nail in his holy place, that our God, the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach El Shai, may lighten our eyes and give us a little reviving in our what? Bondage. Okay? So we're not free out here, man. If you're still paying taxes, you're not free. If you have to wake up 3-4 in the morning to go to work just to keep a roof over your head, you're not free. If you're stressing about life, about where your next meal is going to come from, you know, if you're going to be able to have a house over your head, a roof over your head the next year, you're not free, man. Okay? Verse 9. For we were bondmen, yet our God, which is our power, our Elohim, by Adonai, right, have not forsaken us in our bondage, but have extended mercy unto us in the sight of the kings of Persia, to give us a reviving, to set up the house of the Most High, and to repair the desolations thereof, and to give us a wall in Judah and in Jerusalem, which is the holy city, or it could be referred to as the people. Okay? So I wanted to throw 9 in there to let you know who's being spoken of right here. This is not the whole world, all right? This is speaking about Judah and Jerusalem, which is a part of the 12 tribes of Israel, man. Right? I'm going to go to the book of Isaiah, chapter 1. And I'm going to start at verses 10 through 15. All right, here we go, verses 10 through 15, and it reads, "Hear the word of the Lord, the Most High, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of our God," all right, which is the law, statutes, commandments. "Ye people of Gomorrah," okay, so that's where our people were too. We were in Sodom and Gomorrah, which was one of the most sinfulest places on earth at that time, right? Verse 11. "To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, saith the Lord, the Most High? I am full of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats. When ye come to appear before me, Salakia, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts." Verse 13, "Bring no more vain obligations. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies," okay, the calling of assemblies, right, which is your so-called Black Lives Matter, right? You're marching and you're protesting, right? Your vain obligations, that's exactly what that is, man. "I cannot away with. It is iniquity," all right, which is sin. This is what the Most High call your calling of assemblies, man. "Even the solemn meeting," okay? Well, the Black Lives Matter is a so-called solemn meeting, but all of the gatherings that I see, man, it just looks like one big hangout. You know, it looks like a 2020 version of the 1960s and 1970s hippie convention, right? People just hanging out in big fields. You got cookouts going on. They got music playing. Everyone's sitting around holding hands. There's nothing solemn about that, right? So you're not going to be taken seriously, man. Okay? So this is what the Most High call it, man. "The calling of assemblies I cannot away with. It is iniquity, even the solemn assembly." Verse 14, "Your new moons and your appointed feasts my soul hateth. They are a trouble unto me. I am weary to bear them. And when ye spread forth your hands," all right, this is the way you're supposed to pray. Now, this is the Most High saying this, right? "And when ye spread forth your hands," through the prophet Isaiah, you know, just to let you know, right? "I will hide mine from you." Yeah. "When ye make many prayers," all right, your vain obligations and vain petitions, right? "When ye make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood." All right. So when our people were in a sinful nation, which is Sodom and Gomorrah, and following their vain customs and worshiping their gods and following their dogmas and philosophies, we were in sin to the Most High. So whenever something went wrong with us, whenever we went through an affliction, or whenever we had a calling of assemblies, right, or even a solemn assembly onto the Most High, he didn't hear us because we were in sin. It's like our people are today. We're in sin, man. We're worshiping the false image of the beast, right? We're in religious Christianity, all of these different denominations, like 20 to 40 different denominations, right? We're in Islam. We're in Kemet, right? We're in this Pan-Africanism, right? Your RGBs and all that, right? All of these vain groups, man. And none of them are associated with the Most High or keeping his laws, statutes, and commandments, man. Right? So just as we were in Sodom and Gomorrah, some of our people in that sinful nation, just as we are today, the Most High says this right here. "And when ye spread forth your hands," which is the proper way to pray, by the way, "I will hide mine eyes from you." Yeah, "when ye make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood." All right. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 45. And I'm going to start at verses 20 through 25. Okay, so just to reiterate, that's the way you're supposed to be praying, man. You're supposed to have your hands spread it towards the Most High, which is the heavens, and facing the east, which is the holy city, which is Jerusalem, right? So you didn't hear that from the Quran. You didn't hear that from no Muslim thinking that that's a part of the Quran or that's where it came from. This came from the Holy Bible, man. This is a custom of the Israelites, all right? Not of your Ishmaelites, okay, or your so-called Arabs. All right, this is an Israelite custom, man. Okay. And as a matter of fact, as I was saying before, with your so-called prayer hands, right? This is basically what you're doing here, as it says here. Prayers to the Egyptian gods and goddess, right? So you have your two hands right here. This is how it was first. You know, you sort of form like a pyramid, like a triangular shape, right? With your hands. And then, of course, over time, it been changed and, you know, your hands been brought together. But first, this is what this was right here. This is your pyramids, right? So when you're making your vain obligation to the Most High in this gesture, you're really praying to the Egyptian gods and goddesses, as it says right here, man, right? These are the formation of the hands here, right? Your hands together, and then you have your triangular shaped hands right here, right? In this depiction. And then you have this right here. It's basically still sort of forming a triangle. You know what I'm saying? But it's like it's sort of brought closer together. Your palms is brought close together. But as the scriptures that I've brought out so far, that's not the way you're supposed to be praying, man. As it says here in this meme, ancient Kemet term and symbol for praying or paying Slakia homage to Amun-Ra. Who is Amun-Ra? That's your Egyptian sun god, right? As right here on the left side of the screen. Okay, that's your Egyptian sun god there, man. All right. And then it says here, this is why the Greeks and the Romans started saying amen after prayer. And in Islam, they say amen, right? So you have your Greeks, right? And then you have your Muslims in Islam. This is what they say, man, after their prayer. Now, the scripture says pray without ceasing, right? So you're not supposed to stop praying, man. As it says here, after prayer, and in Islam they say amen. So it says after prayer, so basically they're ceasing prayer. What the scriptures say about that, right? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 17, pray without ceasing. All right, so you're not supposed to stop praying, man. Right, and this is in context right here, right? Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort and feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient towards all men, see that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good. What is good? The law, statute, commandments of the Most High, the fruits of the Spirit, right? Living in the Spirit after Hamashiach, right? Both among yourselves and to all men, rejoice evermore. Pray without ceasing, which is engraved in red here, right? So they emphasizing that you're not supposed to cease praying, man. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of the Most High in Hamashiach El Shai concerning you. Quench not the spirit, meaning never get bored of this, man. Always do the work of Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach El Shai. Always remain in the spirit, you know, practicing the fruits of the spirit. Okay, despise not prophesying, which is preaching. Okay, so you're always supposed to be speaking the word, man, and pray without ceasing. All right. So when you're giving thanks in everything, that's giving thanks to Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach El Shai, right? So that's what we're supposed to be doing, man. So as I said before, when you're forming your hands like that, man, you know, when you're doing this right here, as it says right there in that depiction, in that meme, when you're doing this, or when you're doing this, you're tilting your head down on your hand and you have your hand and your palms together in an upward position, that's not the way to pray, man, right? But just as I said before, I understand, you know, our people have been taught this all of our lives through religious Christianity and Roman Catholicism, how to pray. But of course, they worship other gods, man, and other deities, right? They don't worship the one true God of the Holy Scriptures, man, which is Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai, right? So we're going to get back into this here. The book of Isaiah, chapter 45, verses 20 through 25, and it reads, "Assemble yourselves and come, draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations." All right, who's the ones that's escaped from the nations? The ones that's living a holy life, a set apart life, right? The ones who's keeping the laws of the Most High. Okay, "Assemble yourselves and come, draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations, that have no knowledge, that set up the wood of their graven image." Okay, what's the wood of their graven image? That's your so-called crucifix. That's your cross, right? The one that they crucified Christ on. Okay, your Tammuz cross. Okay, that's all it is. It's just a lowercase t, man, right? So it's nothing holy about that. That's an ancient Roman torture device that they used to torture the people who they wanted to kill, man, right? So that's what it is right here. Your wood of their graven image, man. That's your so-called cross there, right? "And pray unto a God that cannot save," okay? So that's your God who cannot save, your false image of the beast that's on that so-called cross, that crucifix, that ancient Roman torture device, right? That's a God that cannot save, okay? Verse 21. "Tell ye and bring them near." Yeah, let them take counsel together. "Who have declared this from ancient time? Who have told it from that time? Have not I, the Most High, and there is no God else besides me, a just God and a Savior? There is none besides me." Okay? So the Most High is definitely reiterating that, man, through the prophet Isaiah. Verse 22. "Look unto me and be ye saved." Okay? So the only way you're going to get saved is looking on to Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach Yahushai with all faith, truth, and sincerity according to the biblical scripture, man. Not Allah, not Buddha, right? Not Santa Maria, aka Saint Mary in Roman Catholicism. That's who they worship, man. They actually worship Saint Mary, right? You're not supposed to worship the mom of Christ, man, right? You're not supposed to be out here worshiping Buddha and Muhammad and Allah, right? You're not supposed to be agnostic, okay? A Luciferian, all right? This is what the Most High says, man. "Look unto me, Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach Yahushai, and be ye saved," all right? "All the ends of the earth, for I am the Most High, and there is none else," all right? Verse 23, "I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Surely shall one say, in the Most High have I righteousness and strength." Okay, so this is where you're only going to have your righteousness and strength, only in the Most High, all right? Not in Islam, not in Buddhism, all right? Not in Hinduism or Taoism, all right? Or Shintoism or in Luciferianism, all right? "Even to him shall men come, and all that are incensed against him shall be in shame," all right? So if you're out here worshiping other gods and other deities, and you're following yourself, your self-willed, your so-called nature boy, right? Your RBG, right? Your Pan-Africanist, right? and your self-willed, your carnal, okay? This is what the Most High says right here. And all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed, all right? So if you're holding your crucifix, your so-called cross, your Egyptian ankh, all right? If you're holding all of your false images of what a god should be, like Buddha, right? Your Buddha, a doll or whatever, or a statue, okay? Your Shintoism, your yin and yang piece or whatever, in Taoism, right? You have all of your graven images, man. This is what it says here again. And all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. And the Most High shall all the seed of Israel, okay, be justified. Not the whole entire world, all right? And shall glory, all right? So this is what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be glorying in the Most High God of Israel, all right? Not in your false image of the beast, not in Muhammad or Allah in Islam, right? Or Buddha in Buddhism, or Krishna in Hinduism, all right? Let's go to Isaiah chapter 46. Okay, we're in the book of Isaiah, chapter 46. And I'm going to start at verse 2 down to 4. And it reads, they stoop, they bow down together. They could not deliver the burden, but themselves are gone into captivity. Hearken unto me, O house of Jacob, which is Israel, right? The 12 tribes of Israel. And all the remnant of the house of Israel, which are born by me from the belly, which are carried from the womb. And even to your old age, I am he. And even to hoar hairs will I carry you. I have made and I will bear, even I will carry and will deliver you. All right. So that's the only God that's going to be able to deliver you out of your captivity and your affliction, man. Which is the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach, I was shy. All right? No other God, man. Right? So no matter how old you are, you could be from 8 to 80. If you have faith with all truth and sincerity in the Most High, the God of the scriptures in Hamashiach, I was shy, as it says here. And even to your old age, I am he, meaning he never changed. The Most High never changed, man. And he haven't changed his chosen people, all right? And even to hoar hairs will I carry you, all right? That's your so-called grays, okay? But the Bible describes it as white hairs, all right? I have made and I will bear, even I will carry and deliver you, all right? Deliver you from all of your troubles, man. Okay? So let's go to the book of Psalm. Chapter 5. And I'm going to start at verse 1. Okay. And it reads, give ear to my words, O Lord, the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach, Awashai. Consider my meditation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God, my power, my Adonai. For unto thee I will pray, or Slakia will I pray. Verse 3. My voice shalt thou hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning will I direct my prayer. Unto thee, I will look up, okay? So when you're praying to the Most High, as I was saying before, right? When you're praying to the Most High, you're supposed to have your hands like this, right? Turn towards the east, right? And your head sort of tilted back, right? looking towards the heavens, looking towards the Most High, not looking downward. Okay, so this is how you're supposed to pray, man. Okay? And as the old saying goes, right? Upstairs is the Most High, right? So who's downstairs? Okay, I mean, you just put one and one together, right? So when you're looking up, you're looking towards the Most High, right? When you're looking down, you're looking towards High Satan, okay? So if you're praying like this, for one, you're praying towards the gods of Egypt, which is Amun-Ra, and you're looking down towards hell, so to speak, right? So you're praying to the goddesses and gods of ancient Egypt, and you're looking towards Hashatan, right? When you're looking down. Okay, so you're supposed to, so like I said, have your hands spread towards the heavens, like this right here, your palms up, and your head tilted back. That's how you pray to the Most High, facing the east, all right? So you got that here out of the Bible, man, right? Not out of the unholy Quran, okay? Technically, the Quran, or the Quran, as they call it, right? All right, so all of this is out of the scriptures, man. This is ancient Israelite custom right here, man. It's not Islamic. It's not Buddhist. It's not Hinduism, right? This is from our nation of people, man. The 12 tribes of Israel. Let's read that again. Verse 1. Give ear to my people, O the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai. Consider my meditation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my power, my Adonai. For unto thee will I pray. Unto thee will I pray. Not to Muhammad, not to Allah, not to St. Mary, not to Buddha, not to Krishna, right? Not to Lucifer and your secret societies, right? Not to the universe, as some of our people like to say, right? Or to your ancestors and African ancestry, right? Or African spirituality, whatever the hell that is, right? Which is necromancy, by the way. I brought that out plenty of times in my previous videos, right? This is what our people are off into, man. So not only do we know the incorrect way to pray, but we off into all of these other false gods and deities, man. Right? Just going way the hell off, right? So as King David saying right here, hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God, for unto thee, the Most High, the God of Israel, right? The God of the Holy Scriptures, will I pray. My voice shall thou hear in the morning, O the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai. In the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee and will look up, okay? So that's how you're supposed to do it, man. Once again, this is the milk deliverance of Israel, the seed souls of Israel, delivering that milk and sowing that seed to our people for their edification. To all of the eyes that see and the ears that hear, right? All praises to the Most High. All right, we're going to go to the book of Psalm, chapter 55. And I'm going to go down to verse 22. And it reads, cast thy burden upon the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. Okay, who is the righteous? The ones that's keeping the laws of the Most High, right? The hopeful elect, the hopeful one-third. The ones that's being ye separate from the world, right? That's not keeping the vain customs of this world, right? Cast thy burdens upon the Most High, and he will sustain thee, or shall sustain thee, Salakia. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved, all right? So the righteous is not going to be moved, man. We're the apple of the Most High's eye. As long as we stand in the spirit of Hamashiach and keeping the laws of the Most High, we shall not be moved, as the scripture says, right? Let's go to chapter 143 in the book of Psalm now. And we're going to start at verse 5 through 7. And it reads, I remember the days of old. I meditate on all thy works. I muse on the work of thy hands, all right, which is the creation of the Most High. You know, sometime like you're, if you're in like a valley or something, you around a mountainous area, or you're around some nice looking woods or something like that, or you're on a nice moonlit beach or whatever, that's all the creation of the Most High, right? So as it says here again in verse 5, I remember the days of old. I meditate on all thy works. And also, you know, the works of the Most High, all of the blessings that he bestows upon people, right? I muse on the works of thy hands. I stretch forth my hands unto thee, okay? I stretch forth my hands unto thee. My soul thirsteth after thee, as I thirst, as a thirsty land. Salah, Salah here, right? Hear me speedily, O Lord, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai. My spirit faileth. Hide not thy face from me, lest I be like unto them that go down into the pit. What is the pit? It's hell. All right? So hell can either be a place or a condition of life, man, if you're suffering in life, right? Like, say, if you're missing a limb, or if you're sick, if you have a terminal illness, right? That's hell. Or for our people in general, the ones that's being oppressed, the one that's being afflicted on a daily day basis, right? Mocked, ridiculed, belittled, okay? Bamboozled, all right? Last hired, first fired, right? You're waking up 6, 7 in the morning, or worse yet, 3, 4 in the morning to go to work to keep a roof over your head, right? You're paying taxes, okay? That's hell, conditionally, all right? So it's not always as depicted. You know, you're down in some fiery place with some red guys with a pitchfork poking you all the time, right? That's not hell, man. That's make-believe hell, all right? Hell is a condition that you're in, man, right? And this is what our nation of people are going through. That's the reason why we're marching now, for so-called justice or no peace, right? Verse 7 again. Hear me speedily, O Lord, my spirit faileth. Hide not thy face from me, lest I be like unto them that go down into the pit. Okay? So that's my point here in verse 6 again. I stretch forth my hands unto thee, my soul thirsteth after thee as a thirsty land. Salah. Okay? So that's my point again, on how you're supposed to be spreading your hands forth with your palms up towards the heaven when you're praying towards the Most High, right? Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8. And I'm going to start at verse 6 through 12. And it reads, therefore, thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways and to fear him. For the Most High thy God, thy power, bringeth thee into a land of brooks of water and fountains and depths that spring out of valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley and vines and fig trees. Okay, and pomegranates, a land of olive, Slakia, oil, olive, and honey. All right, verse 9, a land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness, thou shalt not lack anything in it, a land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. Verse 10. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai, for the good land which he have given thee. All right, so that's another way. You know, sometimes our people think that you're supposed to pray before you eat, right? But this is what it says right here, verse 10. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God, all right? So after you eat, this is when you're supposed to pray. You're not supposed to pray before you're eating, right? Now, don't get me wrong. You can pray whenever you want. If you want to pray before you eat, it's fine. But as it says right here in verse 10, you're supposed to pray after you eat, all right? And after you're full, okay? When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he have given thee, all right? Verse 11, beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God, Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach Yahushai, and not keeping his commandments, all right? So this is what we're supposed to do. The Most High is reiterating this all throughout the Bible, man. Old Testament and New Testament, man, right? But our people refuse to listen and read and keep his laws, right? Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God, which is your God, and not keeping his commandments and his judgments, all right? So we're supposed to judge our people when they're in sin, man. And this is what our people have a habit of going around saying, which is taught to them by religious Christianity and Roman Catholicism, by the way. Oh, don't judge, you shouldn't judge, right? But what the Most High says right here, man. Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God and not keeping his commandments and his judgments, all right? So when you see a people in sin, you're supposed to judge your people. When you see them going off, worshiping false gods and false deities and following vain philosophies and dogmas, you're supposed to judge them, man, right? You see them eating abominable, not keeping a dietary law, you're supposed to judge them. When you see them not keeping the seventh day Sabbath and the moral laws, right? The ceremonial laws, the high holy days, right? You're ready to keep the world's vain customs, right? Like Father's Day, like Juneteenth, okay? Mother's Day, Easter, Christmas, all right? Halloween, okay? You're supposed to judge your people, man. Now, the only way that you can do this is if you're keeping the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High, right? If you're living a lawless life and you're doing the same things like they're doing, then you can't judge them. Then you'll be a hypocrite, right? And then the Most High may judge you for that. All right, so this is what you're supposed to do, man. Forget not the Lord thy God and not keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, okay? Not tomorrow, not back in the day, not back in the ancient times, all right? This day, this very day, okay? Which is June 17th, 2020, all right? Verse 12, lest when thou hast eaten and art full and hast built goodly houses and dwell therein. Okay, we're going to jump down to verse 17. And thou sayest in thy heart, my power and the might of mine hand have gotten me this wealth. All right, so this is when we get proud, man, when we get a little bit of change in our pocket, whatever, or we come into like an inheritance or some money or some wealth or whatever. You know, this is what we say, man. Or when we go to college, you know, we get that those degrees or whatever, or we finally open up a new business, right? This is what we say. And thou sayest in thy heart, my power and the might of my hand have gotten me this wealth. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he, okay, the Most High, Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai, that giveth thee power to get wealth, all right? So the Most High is giving you this power, not you. You know, not your so-called piece of paper from an institution, right? That's telling you, oh, you're smart now, right? So what have you thought about yourself before you got that paper? You thought of yourself to be stupid, right? So the Most High is letting you know, man, he's the one that gives you your wealth and your power, all right? Your wits and your mind, okay? Let's read that again. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, which is your God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he sware unto thy fathers, which is your fathers, as it is this day. Okay. Verse 19. And it shall be, if thou do at all forget the Lord thy God and walk after other gods, okay, after Allah, after Muhammad, after Buddha, after Krishna, okay, after what's that other god, man, in India? What's the ones that the Jatas is from? The Krishna, I think it's Krishna, right? All right, so basically, yeah, that's what it is. You know, you're walking after other gods, man. I got so many gods I can name, you know what I'm saying? And serve them and worship them, okay? The false image of the beast, right? You're worshiping Lucifer and your secret societies. You're keeping the vain customs of all the other worlds, right? You're joining your fraternities and your sororities, right? I testify against you this day that ye shall surely perish, all right? So if you're worshiping Allah, if you're worshiping Buddha, if you're worshiping the false image of the beast in religious Christianity, all right? You're worshiping St. Mary in Roman Catholicism, right? This is what the Most High says against you. I testify against you this day that ye shall perish. Verse 20. As the nations which the Lord destroyeth before your face, so shall ye perish, because ye would not be obedient unto the voice of the Lord your God, your power, your Elohim, man. All right? For the Most High of the Scriptures, man, the God of the Bible is our God, okay? This is the God that we should be following, not practicing yoga and Buddhism and Hinduism, right? And meditating and freeing your mind, man. There's no way in the Scriptures where it says free your mind or worship your ancestors in African spirituality, all right? Which is necromancy, which is a part of witchcraft, by the way, okay? So the Most High is going to destroy you, man. As it says here, I testify against you this day, all right? So if you're out there worshiping all of these false gods and false deities, the Most High testify against you, man. And ye shall surely perish, all right? All right, so I'm going to go to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And I'm going to end that there, all right? So hopefully that this is edifying for the people. When they see this, they will know the correct way to pray to the Most High, the God of the Bible, the Scriptures, all right? It's not holding your hands like this right here in a triangular formation forming the pyramids of ancient Egypt, all right? As you can see here on the right side of the screen, okay? You're not supposed to have your palms together, man. Your so-called prayer hands, right? So that's not the way to do it, man. All right? Or like this right here. And as you can see here again, this all is associated with ancient Egypt, man. You can see all of the Egyptian gods here. You have your circle here, right? And I'm pretty sure everybody know about this sign here. All you got to do is go to your local department store, right? And see that symbol right there. It's in red, though, right? This is what this is. This is the symbol of Amun-Ra, the third eye. Also, it's the planet Saturn from the top view. So when you're looking down on the planet of Saturn, this is the planet here. This is the rings right here, right? So to speak. Okay, your so-called planet, all right? Me personally, I say it's a star, but, you know, of course, that's what science teaches us, that there's planets, right? Salakia. Okay, so all of this is associated with ancient Egypt, man. All of this, okay? So if you didn't know about it, you heard about it first here. At the milk deliverance of Israel, the seed souls of Israel camps, man. Delivering that milk and sowing that seed to our people for eyes to see and ears to hear, right? So we're gonna go to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And I'm going to go down to verse 16. Okay. And it reads, rejoice evermore. Pray without ceasing. All right. Not like you do in religious Christianity or Roman Catholicism or in Islam, right? when you end your prayers with amen or amen, okay? You're not supposed to end your prayer. This is what Paul says through the spirit of Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach Al-Shai, right? Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks to the Most High. For this is the will of God in Hamashiach Al-Shai concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying, prove all things, hold fast that which is good, which is the keeping of the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High, right? Abstain from all appearance of evil, all right? So everything that's evil, man, all of these vain customs of the world, right? The keeping of the so-called holidays, right? Just came from celebrating Father's Day, Mother's Day, Easter, right? All of those days are rooted in paganism, man, and it's all for sun worship, all right? From ancient Egypt and ancient Greece, okay? And mainly ancient Babylon, all right? That's the first opponent of the Most High, man, which was Nimrod and Tammuz, right? And Semiramis. So this is what this is all dating back to, man. So when it says abstain from all appearance of evil, that means just that. You know, stop celebrating these world wicked holidays, so-called holidays, right? And vain customs. Worshiping the image of the beast and all of these false religions, man, and deities, right? And as it says here, prove all things, all right? So basically, this is what I'm doing right now. I'm proving all things. Slaki Israel. Okay. All right. High five. Go in the room, okay? All right. So basically, this is what I'm doing right now in verse 21. Prove all things, all right? Hold fast that which is good. So when I'm proving all things, this is basically what I'm doing right now, right? This is not your so-called way to pray, okay? Prayers to the Egyptian gods and goddesses, all right? That's your hand formation right there, forming the ancient pyramids of Egypt, okay? So I'm proving all things, right? This is another meme right here. I am Amun, Amun Ra, Amun, amen. You end your prayers with my name, all right? Which is an ancient Egyptian god, okay? So this is it right here, man. This is what our people are used to doing, you know? We're going back to Egypt when we do these things unknowingly, right? We all know what the Most High says about Egypt in the book of Deuteronomy and the book of Isaiah, right? We're not supposed to return back to Egypt, man, and trust in Egypt, all right? And spiritual Egypt, okay? So we're going to go back to the book of 1 Thessalonians again. Chapter 5. Starting from verse 16. All right, as it says there in that Amen Ra prayer, okay, this is what you end your prayers in. But what Paul says through the spirit of Yahweh Bahashem Hamashiach Al-Shai, right? Rejoice evermore, okay? Pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks, for this is the will of the Most High in Hamashiach concerning you. Quench not the spirit, meaning always walk in the spirit of Hamashiach, all right? Despise not prophesying, all right, which I'm doing right now, okay? Reading the scriptures, okay? Prove all things, hold fast that which is good, which I'm doing right now. Abstain from all appearance of evil, which our people should be doing, okay? So I'm going to end that there. Right, and hopefully that this was edifying to our people. Hopefully that this was enjoyable. I try not to keep it too long, right? Like most of my videos are, but you know, I decided to do this, man, because you know, I see our people out there going way off, man, especially yesterday. Yesterday was Sunday, of course, for sun worship. A lot of our people went to church, so to speak. And you see them out there, man, they be in the restaurants, you know, you see them out there, they have their little prayer circles at the table before they eat, right? Which the scriptures just said in the book of Deuteronomy right here. Okay. I'm going to bring that out one more time here. I believe that's here in verse 10. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he have given thee. Okay. When thou hast eaten and art full. Okay. That's past tense. All right. So even though I know I brought that out plenty of times before during the video, but I had to reiterate that, right? So basically, this is what our people be doing, man. When you see them at the restaurants, you see them in church or whatever, you know, they're praying incorrectly, man, right? They're forming their prayer circles in public, right? Which you're not supposed to do according to the book of St. Matthew, chapter 6. You're supposed to be praying in your closet, man, in secret, so the Most High can hear your prayer, all right? Not supposed to have your hand in a triangular, circular position, right? You're supposed to have your palms tilted up towards the heavens. Okay, and you're supposed to be facing east towards the holy city of Jerusalem, which is our homeland, man. Okay, all right, so that's it. Hopefully that this was enjoyable. Hopefully that this was edifying for our people. Once again, this is the Milk Deliverance of Israel, the Seed Souls of Israel Camps, coming back at you with another short segment, you know, delivering that milk and sowing that seed for our people, for their edification, to all of the eyes that see and ears that hear, right? Much love to all of the brothers and sisters that's out there pushing this truth with all faith and sincerity, according to the biblical scripture, in the spirit of Yahweh Bahashem, Hamashiach Yahushai. Until the next time, Shalom, Kam Yasharallah.